shed your blood. So I'm gonna live like my shame is gone. Won't be shackled to the way I was. Oh, I'm gonna live like my chains are gone.
Sunday. Can we get a happy Sunday in the chat? We are so glad that you are with us today. Man, how awesome was that worship? We've got one more song coming up after the message. But as we get going, it's awesome to be here. I just want to ask you this one question, okay? What is the best food that you have eaten this week? What is the best food that you have eaten this week? And you can't say that you went out to dinner like, I want the best homemade food. Maybe it was some pasta your mom made. Maybe it was some chicken that your dad made. Maybe you got fancy in the kitchen. I don't know. But what is the best food that you've made? We'd love to see those in the chat. I know for me, the best food, okay? Stay with me here. You're gonna think I'm crazy. But the best food was my wife, shout out to you, Stacy, love you. She made some gluten-free baked ziti. Who knew that you could make pasta with noodles, right? It's crazy. I guess they're called zoodles. I don't know. But it was pretty cool. Gluten-free pasta. Anyways, so glad you're here. A few quick announcements, and then we're going to play a game. And then we've got an encouraging message for you. Number one announcement is just this idea of if you're not following us on Instagram, what are you doing? Okay, follow us on social media. We'd love to be able to connect with you. There you'll find information, updates, different things going on, especially as we talk about reopening over the next few weeks, if not hopefully in the next few months. Guys, we would love to see you in person. So whenever that happens, man, we love that. But also follow us on social media for that information. Second announcement is if you haven't done so already, make sure you have a Bible, you've got a pen, you've got a notebook, just different stuff that you can take down some notes, because this message from Jonathan that you're going to hear in a few moments is going to be powerful. So you want to remember it. You want to have some stuff with you to write some stuff down. But today we are going to play a game. And guys, we have a very special guest, Kayla Smith, everybody. Come on. Can we get a hey, Kayla, in the chat? That'd be great. What's up, Kayla?
Hey, what's up?
How's it going?
I'm just happy to be here.
Me too. I'm happy that you're here. You are singing, which is awesome.
Yeah.
How's that going?
It's super fun.
So good. You've been doing it for a long time.
Yeah.
Was there ever a period that you did not sing?
Like in general?
Yeah, like you were just like, hey, like I'm just not going to sing.
I would say no to that.
Unbelievable.
What about you? Is there ever a time where you didn't sing?
I'm forever singing.
Right.
You know, it's
You're actually, when people say, like, who's your biggest musical inspiration, yeah. I just say Alex Weirdo.
It's actually me.
Yeah.
And for me, too. So,
right.
Thank you for being here. One thing that is just awesome about Kayla that not a lot of you guys know is Kayla is actually a basketball star.
Yeah.
And so today, because the NBA season is back, go Hawks, okay, we are going to play our version of basketball. So let me get our supplies. All right. Our church is under construction, so we had to figure out how we're going to do this. But we've got this awesome pool ring. Okay. And we're going to test out Kayla's range. So I'm going to give you these arrows. Okay. They're kind of dangerous. You're going to need to undo that rubber band. And I'm going to hold this and we're going to see what your range in steps is.
Right.
Okay, so I'm going to start close, and then after everyone, I'm going to back up.
Okay, so I'm not backing up, you're back.
Yeah, actually, if you could back up
to... Like a hoop sturdy, and I could be the one to...
We could do that. That actually might be better. Okay,
so... Let me know when I got no practice.
Yeah, so let's do this. I'll stand here. Okay. If you hit my hand, I'm going to be really upset.
Should I start pretty close, just to be...
Yeah, I think so. And then we'll compare. I'm going to go, because I don't know if you know this. I might have said it once or twice, but I played basketball.
Well, I'm actually on every single NBA
Christian
team.
College, NCAA, D2.
I'm on every NBA team.
No scholarship.
I'm just off-season
Walk on.
Right now, so...
Yeah.
A little out of shape. Okay, here we go.
I wore Nikes.
Well,
all right, let's go. Go ahead, Kay. What did you say?
I said more than twice.
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
All right, let's see. Go ahead.
Okay, wait, this is too easy.
Like, yeah, you need to back up a little. You need to start, like, off the carpet. Off the carpet.
If I wasn't a basketball star, I wouldn't.
Yeah. Totally.
I'm going to start on the carpet.
Okay, it's your world. Ooh. When you talk trash, but get rejected.
Really yeah.
Ouch.
I don't even know if I should keep going. Maybe we should switch.
I think you should keep going, yeah.
Okay,
hey, there you go. You got to back up. Okay. Keep going. Yeah, you're one for two. Woo! Off the rim. Keep going.
Here we go.
America. Oh, sideways.
Oh, this is
harder than it looks.
Guys,
come on now.
He's moving the
I don't even actually know what these are, to be honest with you.
I'm gonna say arrows. I'm like, I've never seen this in my life.
Yeah, I've never.
Just to show you guys.
It was connected to like a present backstage, and I kind of ripped them out.
Guys, happy so, birthday to whoever that was.
Yeah, sorry about your present, Jane. It's like, sorry about that. Yeah, you're doing.
I don't even think I should back up because I can't get it here.
Yeah, you're not doing very well. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Typically, you're not supposed to like criticize your guest, but
yeah,
sorry.
I am on the NBA.
You're doing great.
So.
Can we give it up for Kayla? Come on, people.
Guys.
Let's go.
Okay.
You're better than this.
Like, where it's the most? Okay. It's like completely silent.
Your sister's gonna see this.
I'm thinking about that.
I need you to know that.
Love you, girl.
Come on. Hey, there you go. All right, so you at least you got to find like a marker. This is the last one. This could be the break.
If I don't get it, try to move it to get it in.
Okay, yeah, sure.
I shouldn't have said that in the
moment. No, yeah, it's fine.
Well, it's hard to see, but I did get that. That was
sad
right.
Day. All right, I'm going to go. You got to stay here.
Okay.
So how many tries did you get? One, two.
Every single one that there was.
Three, four. Let's see. 5, 6, 7. All right.
This is actually sponsored by the NBA, so thank you guys.
Again, shout out to the Hawks. Here we go.
Okay.
All right.
Okay,
guys.
So see how the first one is the hardest.
Yeah. This is actually harder than you think. Oh my
goodness. So, 0
I'm a little
two.
Sore. I did something today.
So, okay, should I tell them the score?
Guys,
they
no,
can see it, right?
Hey, there you go. All that counts is distance. We're not going off of how many.
We'll play as a team now. I'm going to try to help you get it in.
All right, bet. It's harder than you think. There you go.
Oh.
That was you.
Oh.
That was in.
I really don't think that's fair.
That was in. How about this? You stay steady like God, okay? And I'll be
here. I'm going to close my eyes.
Thank you.
I'm going to guess you missed it.
It's fine.
I didn't even have to open my eyes for that one.
All right, hang on. This is going in. So everybody, can we give it up for our winner, Kayla Smith? Thank you. Kayla, any words of advice to our students? Kayla just graduated, which is awesome. Any words of advice to our students about following Jesus before you go?
I would say to keep people in your life that will hold you accountable. People your age, people older than you, because it's always better to go through life with people and not alone. Yeah.
Shout out to life groups.
Yes, life groups.
Boom. All right, get off the stage. Thanks. Bye, Kayla. Hey. Thank you again for being here. We have an awesome message that we are going to transition into right now. So I'm going to pray, and then we're going to go into our message. God, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for this time where we can worship, where we can play silly games. But God, most importantly, we thank you that we get to spend this time with you. God, to recognize that you are the supreme authority of this world. And God, right now, we just pray that we would focus our hearts and our minds on you as we dive into your word. Lord, speak to us. God, we just pray that we would leave from this message a brand new person in you. God, we love you. It's in your son's name that we pray. Everyone in the chat said amen. Take it away, Jonathan.
What's up, everyone? Thank you so much for tuning in. I don't think any of us could have foreseen what our reality would look like when we first heard about having to work and learn remotely back in mid-March. Now that we're in the groove in terms of what our lives look like, I'm so encouraged to see so many of you that have decided to tune in weekly to grow closer to God, joining alongside other students to worship God wherever you guys are at, and to continue to make God a priority. If you are tuning in for the first time, or maybe the first time in a long time, I want to encourage you to come back next week. Maybe even go back on our YouTube page and check out other previous messages and worship sets. You can even go back and check out our Revive 2020 camp experience. Shout out in the chat if you loved Revive. The only things that are going to survive this time in quarantine are the practices that you fuel. If you fuel healthy mindset and working out and watching what you eat and pursue healthy living, you're going to look back and see how much your health has flourished. If you fuel knowledge, you'll look back and see just how your knowledge has exploded as you read and as you study, and you've picked up new habits of learning. But if you don't fuel something like your faith, you'll see it slowly diminish until it's just something that you used to do. But if you fuel it, it'll become a source of enrichment to your life, something that blesses you. Scripture and worship, time spent in prayer, and time spent in these services are not only going to draw you closer to God, but hopefully it'll affect your behaviors, your walk out of quarantine, a mature and wise Christian versus someone who talks the talk but doesn't walk the walk. So, if you are new, please come back next week. Check out our other videos and choose tonight to pursue a lifestyle that draws you closer to God each and every day. Sorry for that little tangent, but today we're going to be spending just a few minutes talking about victory, right? If you've been at church for a while, you've heard plenty of people say things like, "We're on the winning side," right? Or "victory is ours," "victory is in our future," or other churchy sayings with that concept of victory being in the forefront. But I want to dive into what the Bible says about victory, some of the misunderstandings about victory that we have, and what a correct perspective leads us to do, right? Let's pray and we'll dive in. Here we go. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this moment that we share with your people, God, that we may worship you together. Thank you for this moment where your children come together. May you bless the time that we have. May my words be your words, and may they fall on our ears and lead to action. It's in your holy and precious name we pray, amen. I want to share a story, right? A pastor I know was celebrating another successful year of ministry. A matter of fact, they were celebrating the closing of a deal of a plot of land that they were planning on building a new church, right? Life had been really good. They had 4 children, 2 boys, 2 girls. They had one of the most successful churches in North America. And it seemed like everything was going really, really well. In the midst of this party that they were holding, the wife of the pastor ends up having a brain aneurysm, right? Ends up being taken to the hospital because she had fallen into a coma, right? She ends up being in a coma for about 4 months. And in those 4 months, countless churches, people across the country, people across the world end up hearing and praying for a miracle to occur, right? For her to wake up, for her to not have any brain damage, for her to effectively be risen in the name of Jesus. We're going to put a bookmark in this story, but come back to the big picture of this whole message. I want to settle some things. Where in the Bible does it talk about victory, and how do we experience victory, right? If you've been a part of church, you've heard words like victory, conquer, conquerors multiple times. But let's look at something called biblical context, or how the scriptures approach a word, phrase, or perspective. I have 2 points, and this is the first one, right? When the Bible uses the word victory or victorious or conquerors, the person doing the conquering is either God or a person being empowered by God, right? So important for us to understand that, right? Some perfect illustrations of where we find this are Deuteronomy chapter 20, right? Where it says, when you go out into battle against your enemies and you see horses and chariots and people more numerous than you, do not be afraid of them, for the Lord your God who brought you up from the land of Egypt is with you. When you are approaching the battle, the priest shall come near to the people and speak. He shall say to them, "Hear, O Israel, you are approaching the battle against your enemies today. Do not be faint-hearted, do not be afraid, do not panic or tremble before them, for the Lord your God is the one who goes with you to fight for you against your enemies, to save you." 2 Corinthians reminds us that it says, "Listen, all Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem and the king Jehoshaphat, thus says the Lord, do not fear or be dismayed because of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's," right? The psalmist writes, "You have also given me the shield of your salvation," right? "Your right hand upholds me, and your gentleness makes me great." One more, the account of David fighting Goliath, 1 Samuel chapter 17, it reminds us, "Then David said to the Philistine, 'You come to me with a sword, a spear, and a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have taunted. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I will strike you down and remove your head from you. And I will give your dead bodies of the armies of the Philistines this day to the birds of the sky and the beasts of the earth, that all on earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not deliver by sword or by spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands." Time after time, we see in scripture that God is doing the conquering, right? When Adam and Eve needed a conqueror, it was God. When the nation of Israel needed a conqueror, it was God. When David needed to conquer, he relied on God. When humanity needs a conqueror for our sin, our only option is Jesus. It's so important for us to realize this truth, because we never want to be fooled into thinking or believing that we are victorious on our own or conquering on our own, right? The Proverbs 21 reminds us that the horse is prepared for battle, but victory belongs to the Lord. Point number two, wherever there is a victory to be had, God is the victor. It's not news to us that we have an adversary, the devil, right? And he's trying to confuse the role that we play in victory. It'll be pretty misleading, and it'll have a misleading effect on your life. So many times we're in tough seasons and situations are tough. The devil may whisper in your ear these lies of, maybe you're not praying hard enough, or maybe you're just not a good enough Christian. If he can convince you that you are the ultimate demise in your lack of victory, then you become blinded and conceited, only thinking about yourself and what you can accomplish on your own. The beginning of a downward spiral in your faith starts with the idea that victory or defeat are yours to win or lose. Don't get me wrong, there's definitely consequences to our sin, right? 9 times out of 10, consequences of our sin are related to the sin we're committing, right? Let's say someone lies and they get in trouble because they lied. That's a consequence of sin, right? Let's say someone gets suspended and they can't play their sport for school for the duration of their suspension. That's a consequence of their sin. It's not like if you cheat on a test and then you get a cavity the next time you go to the dentist. That's not how consequences with God work. Shout out to people hating the dentist, right? Victories advance the kingdom of God, not personal agendas, right? Write that down. Just another thing that's so important for us to understand, right? Let's look at the story of Jonah and the whale, right? We know this story. The original plan was given to him by God to go and prophesy to the nation of Nineveh that God was angry with them and that if they didn't repent, God would destroy their nation. If you know that story, you know that Jonah originally didn't want to go, right? But God kept on interfering. At the end of the story, the victory that was for the kingdom of God was that Nineveh turns from their false idols and false gods and becomes another nation that declares the God of the Israelites as the one true God. Remember, at the end of the chapter, at the end of the book, Jonah preaches, leaves the city because he thinks it's going to explode, right? He climbs up a mountain overlooking the city, and God raises up a plant to give him shade, and a word comes and devours the plant that was giving him shade. And Jonah has just about had it, right? He's had a terrible week. He ran away from God. He was thrown off of a boat. He was swallowed by a whale. And then he comes to this nation that he hates, and they become worshipers of the same God, something that he does not want. In chapter 4, it ends with God saying this to Jonah. But God said to Jonah, verse 9, "Do you do well to be angry with the plant?" And he said, "Yes, I do well. Well enough to be angry, angry enough to die." And the Lord said, "You pity the plant for which you did not labor, nor did you make it grow, which came into being over a night and perished in a night. And should I not pity Nineveh, the great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also much cattle?" Let's not get things twisted, right? There was definitely a victory that day. And it was not a victory for the prophet of God. It was a victory for his enemy. But let's not misunderstand things, right? This victory for this prophet of God's enemy was a victory for the kingdom of God itself. If you look at things as victory or defeat for you alone, then you lack kingdom vision. Then you will miss out on celebrating the victories that God himself celebrates. This brings me back to the story that I opened up with, right? This church and nations all around the world were praying for my friend's mom, the wife of a very successful pastor with a booming church celebrating expansion, celebrating a new church building. And she's in a coma for 4 months, and at the end of the 4 months, something happens that no one expects. My friend's mom passes away. So many people across the world were praying for her to wake up. I actually talked to a bunch of students in their ministry who were starting to doubt God because they were experiencing a personal loss. But if we know God is who he says he is, and if we know that God is always victorious, then how can a personal loss also be a victory for the kingdom of God? I think for Jonah, he was solely looking at things from his human perspective. Nineveh was the capital of this nation called Assyria, and there was this rival nation to the Jews, right? Jonah's perspective, he just confirmed the defeat of his nation. Not only were the Assyrians bigger, stronger, 10 times more aggressive, now they had God on their side. And they were wanting to, and their history showed them that they wanted to enslave and take over the Israelites. Does Jonah's perspective make sense? Of course. Did God's perspective make sense for Jonah? It didn't. But we're not the ones who get to decide what victory looks like. It's up to us to change our perspective into understanding that God is victorious and God is good. I am 100% sure that my friend misses his mom, no doubt about it. But is there a victory for the kingdom of God somewhere in that situation? We have to believe so. When things don't go our way, does that mean that we're being punished? Absolutely not. Maybe God is preparing us for his victory, not our own. I think being in the presence of God is far greater, right? Nobody wants to leave their family on earth. Nobody wants to die. But at the same time, Paul reminds us that it is far better to enter God's heavenly kingdom. Paul says in Philippians chapter 1, verse 20, For to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. Yet which shall I choose? I cannot tell. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. Paul is admitting that dying means entering into his eternal residence with Christ, with the God that saves him. Do you remember Jesus' words exactly before he was executed? Matthew 26 reminds us that he was going a little farther, fell on his face, and he was praying, "Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done." Did crucifixion hurt? You bet it. Was it worth it? You bet it. God's victory and victories for his kingdom are not always a personal victory. Maybe you don't get into college. Maybe you don't get the car you wanted. Maybe parents experience job loss or income loss, or you lose your home. Maybe people get sick. Maybe we even lose people. I want us to always think about this. And this is the last verse of this message. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 reminds us, "For this perishable body must put on imperishable, and the mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on imperishable, and when the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting?" The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. God's victory is not always in the best interest of this body, right? But in the best interest of his kingdom, his body. And that's the hardest pill to swallow when we realize that it is better to suffer and suffer for God temporarily while on earth for his glory. And when we do that, we start to see the victories in store for us that are a part of God's kingdom. Students, we can believe in the promises that God has for us, right? John chapter 16 reminds us that I have spoken to you so that these things I have spoken to you so that in me you may have peace, right? In the world you have tribulation, but take courage, for I have overcome the world. First John chapter 5 says, "For whatever is born of God overcomes the world." And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Revelation chapter 20 reminds us that death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. That's our future destiny. This is the second death, the lake of fire. Death has an expiration date. Victory is God's. He has overcome death, and so can we. We'll definitely experience personal loss in more ways than one. Death is a reality for everyone that's alive, but the Bible promises not only spiritual resurrection, but eventually the resurrection of our physical bodies, and a new heaven and a new earth that none of us want to miss out on. I'm going to wrap up, but we're going to go into one more song. And as we sing this today, I want us to celebrate the victories that we're going to have in Christ. As we sing, let's not be blinded by the belief that victories are ours to win or lose, or that we'll always be benefiting our own body. But as we sing, constantly remind yourself that this victory is God's, and it's for his kingdom. And if we're a part of his kingdom, then that is far better than any personal victory that we can experience. Let's pray. And we're going to sing together. Heavenly Father God, I thank you for the truths of your scripture, that if there's ever a victory to be had, it's either you or people being empowered by you that win. and that victories always bring closer the kingdom of God. God, may we not be fooled into thinking that every victory is going to benefit this physical body, but may we believe and work knowing that every victory that is yours benefits and moves forward your kingdom. And if we are a part of your kingdom, then we will do anything we can and persevere through anything that we can and work through anything that we can because we are a part of your kingdom. God, may this song that we sing remind us of the truths of your scripture, that yours is the victory, yours is the power, and we worship you forever. It's in your holy and awesome name that we pray. In the name of Jesus, amen. Let's sing together.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail.
No, he won't.
My God will never fail. And I'm gonna see a victory. And I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. And I'm gonna see a victory. Yes, I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
There's power.
see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. And I'm gonna see a victory, yes, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. And I'm gonna see a victory, yes, I'm gonna see a victory, for the
again, so much for joining us. Right now, we're going to do what we do every single Sunday and go to life groups. Okay, life groups are a time where we get to connect and talk about what we just heard from God's Word and from Jonathan. Jonathan, thank you so much for that encouraging message. And here's what I'm going to ask. If you don't have a life group or you don't know your life group Zoom link, text that number in the video description. We will get that to you. Go ahead and tell us in the text message your name and your grade, and we can get that out to you as fast as possible. If you're new, man, text that number. We'd love to get you connected with a life group, get to know you a little bit, and make sure that you know what's going on with that stuff as well. But head to your life groups now. Make sure you tell your group leader that they are awesome and you appreciate them taking time to encourage you. And we will see you guys next Sunday. See ya.